The field of astrobiology and the search for life elsewhere, there are areas that have been under considerable fire from their inception. Despite a lot of interest from the public, they've been criticised from academic quarters for being speculative or even unscientific. And the paleontologist George Simpson famously described the SETI program, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, as a gamble of the most adverse odds in scientific history. However, over the last couple of decades, we've learned an awful lot, not only about our galaxy, but also about life on Earth and the conditions under which we can survive. We now know of bacteria and lichens that can survive and thrive under the most hostile conditions that we can currently imagine. High pressures, high temperatures, there's even a family of bacteria, the radiocurans, that can happily live under conditions of quite high radioactivity. And it seems more than presumptuous to assume that the most extreme conditions under which some form of life could survive are represented on our Earth. At the same time, we know an awful lot more as well about the makeup of our galaxy, the types of planets and systems that could in theory sustain life, and how much of them are out there, how many of them are out there. Even just based on our current knowledge of biology. But these criticisms still persist. Now, this is partly due to our failure in this very early stage of the search to find life. Partly it's due to some fairly irresponsible science by the likes of NASA. And a large part of it, though, is due to the consistent trotting out of arguments that are based on information that is years, if not decades, out of date. Therefore, it's our pleasure today to be able to invite Professor Milan Cirkovic to address these arguments, to update the state of play and the state of the argument, to expose criticisms that are based on information that's decades out of date, and to put us straight on the state of the field of astrobiology and the search for life elsewhere. Milan, as well as being research professor at the Astronomical Observatory of Belgrade and associate professor at the Department of Physics in the University of Novi Sad, is one of the FHI's most valuable contributors. He's been co-author on a number of very important publications, including co-editor of our seminal 2008 Global Catastrophic Risks book. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Milan Cirkovic.
It's really a privilege to be here today, and I wish to thank all of you, and especially Shona Higerty on this nice introduction and organizing everything, and my dear friend and colleague Nick Bostrom, who, as you have heard, is traveling about now, so he'll be absent, which might be good a little bit, because I'm going to criticize his view at one point, but I'm not okay. Anyway, this is a very complex topic. 2 years ago, I gave a talk at this place about which was dealing with Fermi's paradox and Carter's argument, which are also classic sort of skeptical arguments against complex extraterrestrial life and extraterrestrial intelligence, and at that time I told you something about, okay, there is a third argument which is probably the strongest of them all, but I cannot address it here, so it's right about time to discuss that third argument a little bit. I'll start with this motto, which is very appropriate for the whole enterprise of astrobiology, because we need to expect the unexpected in Heraclitus' words. Because the phenomena we are dealing with is so complex, and the situation depends on so huge number of parameters that we are right to miss small details which can turn out to be of crucial importance. Now, astrology is usually defined as per NASA's roadmap through these three so-called canonical questions, which deal symbolically with past, present, and future, if you wish, of life and intelligence. And we can regard it as sort of iconic symbolics in Miller-Urey experiment, which was first experiment of organic synthesis on something a little bit like the early Earth, and then which was far in our past, 3.8 billion years or so, and then we have so protein synthesis, which is the basis of life nowadays, and we can envision SETI projects like this old idea of Cyclops radio telescope for search for extraterrestrial radio signals as a sort of a gauge or sort of a metric how to deal with the future of life and intelligence in Earth and in space. Now there are many philosophical implications in the whole astrobiology and SETI enterprise, and there is a sort of something which is usually, and this is a nice cartoon, I don't know whether you see it, I mean, but they are discussing, are you reading that there are planets peopled by folks with advanced brains? On the other hand, maybe we have got the most brains, maybe our intellects are the most advanced. And either way, it's a mighty sobering thought. So any outcome of astrobiological research would have important philosophical consequences, which was realized early on. I mean, even in the famous Schrödinger's book, What is Life, in 1944. And of course, there are many questions which have been posed, some of them very recently, like Hall's problem, which is very interesting, sort of an anthropic-inspired problem. And if you allow me 3 seconds of shameless self-promotion, then you can read about some of this in my recent book, The Astrobiological Landscape, which was published sort of a month or 2 months ago in that other place. So, okay, now three classic anti-SETI arguments are, as I mentioned, we have Fermi's paradox, which is usually dated about 1950, although there were earlier ideas going back to Konstantin Tsiolkovsky and some other thinkers at the beginning of 20th century, and the Carter's anthropic argument, which is rather new, appeared first time in 1983. I won't talk about them now. I will concentrate on the third one, which is usually called the argument from biological contingency over Simpson's argument. That is appropriate since it appeared in a sort of a closed and well-defined form in a paper by George Gellar Simpson in 1964 and has been repeated countless times from that time on. So we are close to half centennial of that paper, so we need to, in a sense, update our thinking and reconsider everything which is related to the problem of biological contingency. Is it really at odds with the basic tenets of astrobiology and search for extraterrestrial intelligence? Now, the importance of Simpson's argument is huge, actually. I show you only 3 quotes out of dozens of similar quotes. Even people who are very much pro-SETI and supporters of SETI, like Paul Davies, claim that this is the most powerful and persuasive argument of all. And of course, the opponents of SETI, people like Ernest Mayr and Tipler and George Vasala and many others, actually have used the ideas which originate back with Simpson's 64 paper. Even more, in contrast to some other fields which are controversial, skeptical arguments have actually influenced the very, how to say, bread and butter course of research, in a sense that cutting of funding for SETI was in some case justified, at least verbally and officially, by appealing to some of these skeptical arguments, especially this Simpson's argument, which in the version of Mayr was explicitly used in the discussions in the US Congress in 1993 about cutting support for NASA's HRMS, that is High Resolution Microwave Survey, which was basically sort of a flagship NASA SETI activity, which was after about 1 year of operation was cancelled in late 1993. And that was actually the last big state-supported SETI endeavor so far. So all subsequent ones were either very small or were funded exclusively by private funders. So in a sense, the skeptical arguments are not something which is completely and purely academic in that sense. I mean, it influenced the course of research and many historians of science, particularly Stephen Jay Dick, who was for quite a long time NASA's official historian, concur entirely with that, that basically said they found itself in a sort of very unenviable position by being exposed to such a strong skeptical arguments from the start. Okay, in the rest of this talk I will present first of all Simpson and his 64 paper, and then discuss various versions of his argument, and of course also how we can undermine it, and of course how we can strengthen it as well, because it is sort of a very competitive game, and of course we'll see how does it play further. Actually, the first inspiration for Simpson, which he acknowledged, came from Alfred Russel Wallace, who was not only a co-discoverer of the theory of evolution by natural selection, and remained, as in the title of recent biography of him, In Darwin's Shadow. He was actually a precursor of astrobiology with two books of his. First was A Man's Place in the Universe, which was published in 1903, and the second was even more, so to say, practical, which was entitled Is Mars Habitable in 1907. That was actually the first book which was discussing it in great detail on completely scientific and non-religious and non-philosophical, or maybe a little bit philosophical basis, whether our nearest habitat for life, Mars, is really habitable or not. Now, in Man's Place in the Universe, Wallace advanced something which would become known as the rare earth argument in the last 10 years or so, after publication of this book by Ward and Brownlee, Rare Earth in 2000, which is actually arguing that you have a number of independent conditions which are necessary for evolving any sort of complex biosphere, especially the one including intelligent observers such as humans. And so these conditions are a very heterogeneous set, belong to several different disciplines, and they are very unlikely to be fulfilled at one place anywhere in the galaxy. Now the problem with Wallace's argument, of course, first of all, the problem is that he used an extremely wrong picture of the universe, of the architecture of the universe. His cosmology, so to speak, was based on Kapteyn's universe, which was very small, which was a set of stars nearly spherical in shape, about, in modern terms, about 2 kiloparsecs. In some versions, 2 to 5 kiloparsecs in a radius, so it is very, very small galaxy, and nothing is there outside of it. And Wallace argued, together with some astronomers of that time, of course, completely off the mark, as we know now, that the solar system must be located near the center of our galaxy. And he also claimed that this is actually what shows further that Earth must be rare, because conditions which are satisfied only near the center of the stellar system are satisfied for a very small number of stars, so a very small number of potential planets, very small number of potential sites for life. So if there are other filters, other conditions which are necessary to be satisfied, then it's quite improbable that the same or similar thing will happen again. Now, Simpson was much motivated by Wallace. Of course, Simpson was, of course, a classic of 20th century biology and paleontology especially. He was one of the major architects of the modern synthesis, which is the so-called neo-Darwinistic evolutionary theory which we have now. His specialty was the history, evolutionary paleontological history of mammals, especially mammals in the tertiary, so that means after the great extinction at KT boundary. And he wrote several books, out of which this one, The Tempo and Mode in Evolution, was always considered a classic. It was published in 1944 and it was a major contribution to the modern evolutionary synthesis. And of course there was an extremely interesting and important monograph of his, which is entitled Simply Horses, in which he actually showed that the idea of some form of progress or progressive trend in evolution is completely wrong, and it's complete illusion, because actually horses, which are quite close to humans in both morphological space and in terms of our recent history, especially in historical and slightly prehistorical times, horses are actually very unsuccessful evolutionary lineage. Similar to humans, there is only one major species of horses present at this moment, and there are many of them which are not extinct. And so, completely contrary to our intuition, I mean, horses are almost at the verge of extinction in terms of deep time, I mean, in paleontological terms. And he also did other important jobs. He was a precursor of punctuated equilibrium ideas about macroevolution, and he was the first to understand the importance of intercontinental migrations of species all around the world. But he was a very interesting, complex, and even a bit conflicting personality as well. You can see here, it is his uniform, because he was a major in the US Army. He was from time to time interested in very speculative topics. For instance, he wrote a very interesting paper, although it's wrong, it's considered wrong nowadays, about the influence of cosmic rays on biological evolution. And he was, one of his personal quirks was his strong and even almost violent opposition to the idea of continental drift, or what is nowadays called plate tectonics. And he even opposed it well into the 1960s, where there was overwhelming evidence about the motion of the continents, and over almost everyone else, I mean, accepted the idea that continents are not fixed and that they are moving and stuff like this. And he was also a very big SF buff, and I mean, he was by his own admission. And after his death, his daughter, Joan Simpson Burns, found the manuscript of his SF novel, which he never published during his life, which is called The Chronization of Sam Magruder, which is an interesting sort of story of time travel. Something dealing with dinosaurs, which you can see from the very cover. So he was a very interesting person. He wasn't the sort of your classic sort of some conservative old fart, I mean, who is somebody who will criticize everything new which appears. But on the other hand, his attack on what was then called exobiology, which is now in more general context called Western biology, appeared in highly prestigious, of course, I don't need to remind you, Science, in 1964, volume 143, and which was entitled The Non-Prevalence of Humanoids. The title itself is very strange and caused a lot of confusion subsequently. In a sort of prelude to the main topic of his, the argument from consistency, he committed a sort of a big epistemological blunder, as almost everyone now agrees, because in trying to put down exobiology and to disparage people like Joshua Lederberg and others who were doing research in exobiology, he claimed that this is a curious development in view of the fact that the science, under quotation marks, has yet to demonstrate that this subject matter exists. And he also insisted on an extremely narrow view of science, that statements which cannot be checked by observation are not really about anything, or at very least they are not about science. So this is very strange, because after all, I mean, this would include some of his own statements from the realm of science. And there are many things, I mean, as people, some of commentators subsequently showed, that there are many things which were entirely good science much before they were actually discovered or their existence was confirmed. I mean, some of them are well known, like Hobbes or Higgs boson as well. Artificial intelligence also, I mean, we don't know actually whether artificial intelligence is possible or not. So we certainly haven't made to found it yet, but nobody seriously will deny that this is a science. And of course, I mean, and he also discusses subsequently in his paper extrasolar planets, which were completely speculative until about 1995, because earlier so-called detections of extrasolar planets prior to 1995 are shown to be spurious, or usually just observational artifacts. So there are many things, actually, we can talk in a scientific way without without actually being sure in their existence. Second thing is that astrobiology, at least, maybe in today's rendition, maybe not as people defined exobiology in the 1960s, is about cosmic life in general, not just extraterrestrial life. Never minding the fact that extraterrestrial, that the attribute extraterrestrial is very hard to clearly and sharply define nowadays, because we are nowadays aware, in contrast to earlier decades, in contrast to 60s, that there is a sort of a continuous exchange of matter between Earth and our cosmic environment. So what exactly is extraterrestrial is very hard to define. When you think about Martian meteorites which are found on Earth, and there are terrestrial meteorites on Mars now, whether they are part of extraterrestrial life, or if, suppose, we find traces of life in them, as there were several claims. Whether this is extraterrestrial life or not, it's very much open to this, to debate. And all that leads to a new understanding, a new paradigm, which can be encapsulated in very title of the book which was published a couple of years ago by Oxford University Press, as called Astrobiology of Earth. Astrobiology of Earth is a completely respectable and sensible title. Simpson passes, after this sort of blunder in the beginning, he passes on to more serious matter, especially extrasolar planets. At that time, there were none known for sure, although there were, as I mentioned, some false alarms. But he clearly was quite conservative about that. So he claimed that it is not impossible that our descendants may someday but it is far beyond our present capabilities or any reasonable extrapolation from them. So it's extremely conservative approach. But luckily, our descendants turned out to be some of still living astronomers at that time, and certainly their children. I mean, so because nowadays we know a whole bunch of planets. As of yesterday, there were 837 confirmed cases in 160 different planetary systems, including very strange things like planets around pulsars, planets around brown dwarfs, majors or massive compact halo objects which are located in halo of the Milky Way, far above or below, if you wish, a plane of our galaxy. But most of them are still orbiting normal stars. Now, of course, they are quite different. Most of them are quite different from the solar system, but this is mostly due to limitation of our technology. It is expected widely that with the advance of new generation of space telescopes, we will be able to discover tens of thousands. The number will be very soon, before this decade is out, in tens of thousands. And that objects which are more similar to the solar system will be found. Here, if we plot how distant, roughly speaking, or semi-major axes of planets which are discovered from their parent stars, we see that we couldn't really find something which is completely analogous to our solar system, because it would require to have a planet with one Jupiter mass. All masses are here in Jupiter masses, which are at 5.2 astronomical units, which is actually too far out for the present. But this is just sort of a limitation of our present technology. In addition to this whole bunch of planets, we have studies of atmospheres of some of them, because some of them can be analyzed through their absorption lines when occulting or transiting the disk of their parent stars. We have discussions of plate tectonics, long-term orbital stability, and stuff like this. In general, we have more and more approaches to discussing habitability of extrasolar planets and their satellites. And we also have observed the formation of planetary system. This is the famous star, which is visible by naked eye from the southern hemisphere with Beta Victoris or Beta Pig, which is actually, when you cover the glare from the parent star, what you see is a warped protoplanetary disk, which has a hole in the middle. The hole in the middle corresponds to planets which have already formed around it, and the rest of the disk is still condensing into planets under our eyes. Typical modern estimates for number of the planets in the Milky Way comes to the fraction, basically a fraction of starless planets is between 1/4 and 1. So that would mean that there are between 75 and 300 billion planetary systems, only in our galaxy. And you know, Simpson quoted Shapley there about having 100 million planetary systems in the whole visible universe. So we have much more reason to be optimistic. Now the point is, of course, not to disparage Mark Simpson for his failed prediction. That would be very bad manners and bad history of science, which is called something which is called British history of science, which is unfortunately often encountered, but we should avoid it if possible. The point is something else, to show that the conservatism is unreliable, especially in rapidly developing fields such as astrobiology. So his claim that this is something which is far beyond our present capacity or any extrapolation from them has turned out to be so far off the mark, so that we are fully entitled to ask whether this might be the case for the rest of skeptical discourse as well. So we can, in view of that, we'll discuss the central argument. First of all, let's see. What is it about? It's about evolution, history of life, of course, which, as you can see here, everything which we consider representative of our complex biosphere, which includes us, is rather new. I mean, it turns out that only in the last half a billion years, from roughly speaking, from Cambrian explosion to this day, we have this complex life. Earlier, there was life since 3.8 billion years ago, but it was mainly unicellular life or with some small colonial organisms and some simplest multicellular organisms, and maybe near the end of Proterozoic there were this Ediacaran fauna and stuff which were a little bit more like plants and animals which we know and them today. But anyway, about maybe 4/5 or 7/8 of the whole history of life, life was very simple. So there was some sort of event or series of events which created a complex biosphere out of which we conserve everything which we see nowadays emerged, and we ourselves emerged in a very, very, very small interval of geological time. So people have known for since Darwin and Wallace, of course, that this is not something which is deterministic and predictable in a sense that mechanical effects or maybe celestial mechanics or some simple physics is predictable. And Darwin also wrote about this in that famous last paragraph of his Origin of Species, where he contrasted actually which is something which like simplicity of the Earth, of the motion of the Earth around the Sun, with complexity of some entangled bank, river bank with complex ecosystems in it. But he was quite firm in his belief that there is a sort of the same underlying rules to both of them. So never mind that one is simple and one is very complex, they are all grounded in the same laws of nature. And the thing is that the same laws of nature can produce results which are either predictable or unpredictable at some particular point in time, is actually the basis of the idea of evolutionary contingency. Now, Simpson's argument in a nutshell is that due to this contingency, evolution is opportunistic and unpredictable on Earth as well as on any other habitable planets. And since we are results of a very long chain of evolutionary events, which are contingent, each link in this chain is contingent. Now this is extremely unlikely to be repeated anywhere else, with sufficient degree of similarity to us, which are essentially humanoids of the Simpsons title, and subsequently our setting efforts are simply bound to fail, so they are wasteful and futile. Now, the problem is, what is a humanoid? As Simpson says, a humanoid is a natural living organism with intelligence comparable to man's in quantity and quality, hence with the possibility of rational communication with us. And he also adds that it's an atom in this means of communication not defined as identical to ours. Now, this is a very meek disclaimer, so he actually of course they are not defined as such, but unfortunately it seems that the confusion which this definition created actually persisted, and Simpson also played a little bit on it himself in a sort of rhetorical way, so that he actually used some opportunities to confuse two possible senses. So one is obviously morphological sense, which is the sense in which we use the term humanoid in the vernacular speech, or if you wish, in robotics, where it's quite clear that when you say humanoid robots, that means robots which have, say, two legs and two arms and a head and something which is morphologically similar to humans. Now, Simpson actually tries to put through the other sense, which can be called biosemiotic sense, in which actually this is the means of communication, which is, and the presence of the possibility of rational communication, which actually discriminates between humanoids and some other products of evolution. But this is this is something which, especially subsequent commentators, people like Tipler and Meyer, have actually forgotten about, and they used and misused the confusion which is present in the original Simpson study. Now, it's obvious from, if you regard the universe of science fictional discourse, that people have imagined both humanoid and non-humanoid aliens, but still even non-humanoid aliens, like Formics of Orson Scott Card's novel, or Bugs of Heinlein's Starship Troopers, something like this, are effectively biosemiotic humanoids in Simpson's definition, because even if we make war with them, I mean, we still can communicate with them, even if we are at war with them, for instance, as in first of Orson Scott Card's Enter series or not. Of course, if you have humans like Klingons and other like Star Trek universe races, then it's obvious that they are humanoid in both morphological and biosemiotic sense. This has been confusing at several other places, or even Simpson himself emphasized that subsequent, for instance, his at page 774, he writes the assumption that one life gets started anywhere, humanoids will eventually appear, explaining false. And then in the very next sentence, he says, chances of duplicating man on any other planet is the same as the chance that the planet and its organisms have had a history identical in all essentials with that of the Earth through some billions of years. So actually, this is we have humanoids in the first sentence of the quote, and then talk about man in the second one. So even if we allow for possibility of an accidental slip of pen, it's important to understand that the usual argument from contingency is ambiguous in its original form. And not only has the locution humanoid been so poorly chosen, but also the reference of man makes sort of mockery of the intended generality of the argument. Now, what can be usual? Further confusion stems from the fact that subsequent commentators actually meant two different things, although quite closely related to when they were talking about Simpson's argument. The other is some, first one is something which is related to what Wallace wrote and which is related to the modern rare earth style arguments. It says, okay, we have some independent probabilities, probability of habitat planets, times probability of biogenesis, times probability of evolving humanoids, say for instance in biosemiotic sense. These are independent probabilities. When they are multiplied, they give some very small number, and then that means that the probability of having a meaningful SETI program is null or effectively zero. Here is something which is actually relevant here, and it's very hard to understand why. He said probability of the evolution is predictable. Now it's completely unimportant, as some people pointed out, Orley, McGovern and Orley in a book which was published in 1966, only 2 years after Simpson's paper, but which is now largely forgotten, which is a pity. They actually claim that it is completely irrelevant whether evolution is predictable or not. We don't. The only thing is whether the outcomes fill sufficiently large part of the overall morphological space or not. And now here comes the second thing, which are usually to some authors associated with Simpson and Simpson's argument, and that is exactly that since the measure of that part of morphological space corresponding to humanoids is small, when we add contingency of evolution, which is basically something similar to randomness of trajectory of evolution in the morphological space, then we end up that, of course, I mean, if you have a small subset of a large set, and then if you are moving through a large set by a random walk, then you will obviously have a very small probability of ever entering this small subset. So there is resulting a small probability of evolving humanoids. So this is actually sort of a supporting argument to this main one, which tries to state that the probability of evolving humanoids in general, biosemiotic sense, is very small. So in a sense, we can give it a better modern form. Nowadays, we can discuss it in sort of a syllogistic form. Where we have four assumptions. First, two are almost self-evident, that we are an intelligent communication capable species, and the second is that part of the overall morphological space representing humanoids in morphological sense is negligibly small. So that's obvious. The second part is obvious. I mean, it's also part of a sort of a Copernican assumption, which is necessary actually to reach some sensible conclusion. And it's obvious from the very fact that humans appear so late and primates appear so late on the evolutionary scene that part, that chunk of the morphospace must be small. Now the third assumption is that the rate of independent evolution of subspecies is x proportional to the size of that part of morphological space representing subspecies. So it's also quite natural to assume something like this. This is an analogy with the famous Boltzmann's formula in statistical physics, which says that the entropy is k times ln W, or that the entropy is proportional to logarithm of statistical rate, or very roughly speaking, probability. So in essence, we may justify it by sort of coarse graining of biological morphospace. And of course, we have the most controversial is his fourth assumption, that is the part of morphological space representing intelligent communication capable species is congruent with that part of morphospace representing humanoids. Of course, if we accept all these premises, then the conclusion that the probability of detecting another such species is negligible. And that was the point of Simpson's argument. Of course, the most controversial assumption is number four. And here we can symbolically have two different cases, in which the case which Simpson envisioned is something like this. You can imagine morphospace like this. Of course, morphospace has a large number of dimensions similar to the phase space in classical statistical physics. But you can symbolically suppress all dimensions and imagine it simply divided into some chunks or some volumes corresponding to coarse graining, to something which is microscopically different but macroscopically similar or identical. Now, it is possible that all intelligent beings, no matter which morphology, are located in a so small chunk of morphospace. Now, this is obviously an exaggeration which is due to just for graphic purposes, but you can think about this as something like 10 to the minus 100 or something, 10 to the minus 1000 of the entire volume of a morphospace. This is one case. And the other case is, of course, that this chunk is something which is not really big, but still appreciable, which would mean, essentially, that intelligence is sort of is an attractor, maybe small attractor, or it has some positive or negative value. So it corresponds to a sort of elevation in the fitness landscape, or the Chomsky, for instance. And that would mean that a chunk of morphospace corresponds to corresponding to any kind of intelligent beings is reasonable or comparable to some other important traits which we have encountered in biological evolution. Now, whether this case A or B is the real thing, we don't know. So that's the Simpson argued for case A, but until we clear out whether this is true or not, and we cannot really accept the premise 4 of Simpson's argument. Now there is some important thing, which is actually quite accidental for Simpson, but it is very important for us now, because he was actually the first to explicitly mention in print the possibility that intelligence may in fact in the long run have negative adaptive value, which is very relevant from the point of view of discussing existential risks. He said, okay, then like intelligence is a marvelous adaptation, blah blah blah, which everybody else says. But also, he says there is a serious hitch here, and maybe we're going to use one other aspect of his intelligence to wipe out himself out. In that case, if that happens, it will happen at a very short time scale in comparison to general biological timescales. So this will actually show that the adaptiveness of human intelligence would have been short-lived indeed, and the argument from its apparent adaptiveness would be negated. Now that is very important, very important thing. There were people who were mentioning something like this in a sort of a jocular and funny context, among them Einstein and Bertrand Russell, and probably before. But Simpson was actually the first who wrote it down and published it in obviously sort of a major peer review paper. So this is interesting because this is directly connected to our dilemma whether case A or case B is relevant. That's exactly the point where I vehemently disagree with Nick, because he actually argues that we should, if we are optimists toward the future and the resolution of, including resolution and successful management of existential risks, then in any case we should accept something like this, like case A. My contention is that if you are optimists about, if you wish to be consistent optimists about the future of humanity, then we must root for case B anyway, because only case B shows you that the intelligence is really a trait with high adaptive value, high positive adaptive value, of course. Okay, now how can we criticize Simpson's argument? First of all, it's sort of a temporal argument which has no temporal structure, which is probably why it is so dear to some philosophers. But in essence, I mean, it completely disregards the possibility that actually part of the more relevant part of the morphospace changes with time as well. So that we would expect that humanoids, however they are defined, evolve into something. And it's reasonable to say that at least assume that some of those evolutionary trajectories would be hugely successful. So in that case, that would mean that the chunk of morphospace corresponding to an intelligent being would change with time, which cannot be accommodated in Simpson's argument. And of course, as other arguments based on evolutionary contingency, any counter-argument which argues for convergence will undermine it as well. Now there are all sorts of various convergence type ideas and arguments. There are some rather moderate ones, like those of Richard Dawkins and Gerard Fermat, which I mentioned later. There are some extreme ones, like Simon Conway-Morris, for instance, who actually takes quite seriously the Star Trek idea that, you know, distant planets, if at all habitable, they must be populated with people who are not only humanoid morphologically, but they are also, he talks in his book, Life Solution in 2000, country. He talks about smiling bipeds, and he talks that they will give you flowers if you land on their planets and stuff like this. So that's sort of an extreme convergentist view, I mean, which would actually, I guess, Simpson himself would find very, very amusing. And the thing that, on the other hand, I'll return to convergence in a moment. But there are other ways of undermining Simpson's argument. If there is a real theory, there is usually its EQ or encephalization quotient, which is often mentioned as a sort of morphological metric which links physical properties of an organism to possible things like intelligence and other mental phenomena. Now, EQ has been rising since the Cambrian explosion in the last 500,000 years, but it was rising very unevenly. In particular, there are several studies which claim that there is a sort of a knee of the distribution, that the rise was actually steeper before, in the Paleozoic, before the end Permian extinction 251 million years ago. Now, the end Permian extinction certainly wasn't something which was necessary or something which was, you know, you can imagine it was fated in some sort of metaphysical way. But probably it was also just a sort of random event on a large scale, whether it was a super volcanic eruption, as most people think, or it was an impact on an asteroid or something like that. Now, all these things are, at least subjectively, at least in a Bayesian sense, are just a random event. Now, it might have been that the end Permian extinction never occurred. So, what would happen in that case? In that case, the EQ, which is characteristic for present-day humans, would have been reached much earlier. Now, nobody really claims, except perhaps Conway Morris would perhaps claim that that would mean that Homo sapiens or something extremely similar to it would have emerged like, I don't know, 50 million years ago, or something like this, 100 million years ago, if there were no end Permian extinction. But you don't need to go that far. It's enough that you say that that there will be sufficiently large EQ at some point in time, which would be reached from a completely different evolutionary trajectory. It would be the same sort of the same peak of fitness landscape which will be reached from another direction simply than what historically occurs. Now if that conjecture is correct, that would mean that Simpson's argument failed, because that would mean that there are multiple paths to neogenesis or to the same peak of the fitness landscape. And of course there is another very prosaic issue as far as that is concerned, even if Simpson was completely right, and even if we cannot really discover anything capable of communication, that might still be detectable. After all, I mean, take some very mundane example: ants, for instance. And ants cannot meaningfully communicate with humans. But of course, the appearance of ants on picnics, for instance, testifies amply that they are completely and entirely capable of detecting humans and human activities. So, in a sense that it is possible, even if we cannot really communicate with extraterrestrial intelligence in a way that founding fathers like Carl Sagan and Frank Drake and Oliver and others suggested, I mean, that we can discover traces of their activities, maybe in forms of astro engineering and other stuff which people have proposed. There is another issue here, which is a very complex issue, so I won't go into that much farther. There is a thing in which convergence actually can be much more ubiquitous than we think, but actually can be effectively hidden by selection effects. Now that was the great paper study by Gerard Vermeij, who we see here, who is a famous evolutionist. evolutionist and paleontologist, blind from his birth, I mean, who wrote several excellent books like this, Nature and Economic History, which I wholeheartedly recommend, who actually investigated whether there is a correlation between multiplicities of some of evolutionary discoveries of some particular traits and the completeness of the fossil record. Now, there are two things essentially which can make a trait disappear from the fossil record. Either it was long ago in the past, or it appeared only in a very small plate. Now, some character, say X, demonstrably evolved multiple times, this clearly is an argument for convergent evolution. Okay. But if we see that X evolved only once, to the best of our knowledge, it is still not an argument for uniqueness or against convergent evolution, since the incompleteness of the fossil record may hide repeated instances of the invention of the same X. So what Vermeer shows is actually that alleged singular innovations tend to be either more ancient or to appear in small plates. Small plates would be undetectable, things located in more distant past would be undetectable as well, in principle. Thus making the observed uniqueness only the latest instantiation of the same, of what is in fact multiple evolution of the same trait. And as Vermeer says, data and arguments indicate that few, if any, innovations are truly unique. So that would be, if that comes to be true, he did a wonderful correlation analysis of some set of traits. Of course, there were other people who were later responding and said, oh, these are not really the traits you should have chosen, etc., etc. But there is sort of an intriguing, some indications to this effect that actually convergence is much more present than it's usually assumed. And of course, there is a sense of in which we need what Iris Fry, a famous philosopher of biology, called the continuity thesis. She applied it to biogenesis, and she claimed there is a famous chapter, that this is an excellent book, The Emergence of Life on Earth, and there is a chapter which is called either chance or design, which is actually the best way of viewing biogenesis today. So we don't have either blind chance, nor we have some sort of design, natural or supernatural, but we have sort of a regular process of continuity. And we have a continuity between physical, chemical, biological evolution, and why not the emergence of intelligence and cultural evolution following it as well. So this would lead, contrary to Simpson's argument where the chunk in the morphospace stays the same at all times, to a radical increase in adaptive values of intelligence, supposedly after some thresholds are passed. And that happens in various transhumanist scenarios where essentially you have cultural evolution increasing the adaptive value of intelligence many orders of magnitude. And of course, but this is not, these are some ways of undermining Simpson's argument, but you can strengthen it as well. This was done by Stanislaw Lem, a great Polish thinker and SF author and philosopher. Now, this especially his last novel, Fiasco, which was published, there is excellent English translation by Grace Harpur, by Michael Kando, and there is a lot of explicit astrobiological discussion in it, and Lem was obviously highly motivated by the discussions of pro et contra and contra SETI. And he actually envisions a situation in which there is obvious detection of an extrasolar civilization, even the mission which visits that planet, but still fails entirely to achieve contact, to achieve meaningful and rational communication. Because there are other things which are also kind of evolutionary boundary or evolutionary limits to possible communication with independently evolved intelligence. And also it has a lot of stuff, I mean it's a wonderful story, I mean I won't go into retelling it, but it has also a lot of discussion about moral dimension of SETI and blah, blah, blah. I won't go into that here. Now the Fiasco argument, as I will call it, is very similar actually to to Simpson's argument in structure, with some crucial differences which make it, in my view, more robust, much more robust than Simpson's argument. The first two premises are identical. Now, Lem introduces something which he calls the window of contact. And the window of contact is a specific interval of time in which you can have either a detection or communication or whatever is our goal in search for intelligent suspects. So that the rate of passage through this part of morphological space is proportional to the size of that part of morphological space, which is even more reasonable than what Simpson originally had in mind. And now comes the crucial equivalent of the premise for in Simpson's argument, and that is that the part of morphological space representing intelligent species detectable by humans, those within the window of contact, is not much larger, at least, in comparison to that part of morphological space representing humans. Now, the thing is that we have moved actually from the existence in evolutionary terms to the detection and possible communication, which is crucially important here. And of course, we need, in order to have that, we need to have a defined sort of a temporal region or the window of contact. Now, advantages are clearly that it explicitly takes into account that intelligent species evolve further after morphogenesis, without actually prejudicating how. And Fiasco argument does not constrain the increase of biological complexity. It is completely in agreement with, say, like various accidents or singularity or anything similar scenarios. On the other hand, it implies the continuity between biological and cultural evolution, and it also breaks the links which I was debating endlessly with Nico, with pessimism or optimism toward the future of humanity. Because you can imagine a situation in which simply human civilization passes out and exits the window of contact with other civilization without actually destroying itself by passing into some other form, some transcendence form or something like some Jupiter brain or whatever. Okay, and for the very end, there is a sort of practical side of the debate which I didn't wish to enter it. And Simpson wrote it in time of the Apollo program, which was the most expensive stuff, I mean, by that time, in any case. And he actually lamented over spending billions of dollars, blah, 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 on space research, which he claimed to be connected with the idea of extraterrestrial life or extraterrestrial intelligence. And he actually said, okay, we can indeed learn more about possible terrestrial life, extraterrestrial life, by studying systematics and evolution of the organisms. And this, the whole stuff provoked the fierce responses and very aggressive comments that actually it was all sort of a manic rhetoric, stuff like this. But unfortunately, I mean, there is one thing in this last part where he was right on target, because biological systematics and evolutionary theory are incredibly important. And unfortunately, there is a deplorable resistance of the mainstream scientific community to take this into account, which is quite unpleasant, and which is actually demonstrated, for instance, in a review given by Jill Tarter in 2001 in the most prestigious annual reviews of astronomy and astrophysics, I mean, which is one of the most highly cited, the most prestigious publication in the entire field of astronomy-related topics, where she never, by a single sentence or a single word, mentions either Simpson's argument or the relevance of evolutionary biology for SETI at all. So this is quite clearly deplorable, and at that point, I mean, we should still learn some lessons from Simpson. Of course, I mean, there are other ways. I mean, if you accept, for instance, even if you accept Fiasco arguments, then we can say, okay, we should not expect to be able to communicate with extraterrestrial intelligence, but we should follow various results and concentrate on manifestations and traces of targets like astroengineering objects like Dyson shells and various space elevators and stuff like this. So we can perform a sort of search for astroengineering which would not be constrained actually by the naive requirement that now we wish to say hello to extraterrestrials and to communicate with them, stuff like this. And so in essence, I conclude with, of course, very preliminary conclusion that it is a sort of a draw so far. Because actually, both Simpson's arguments and refinements, like the fiasco argument, are incredibly important. But they cannot be really seen as decisive. And especially as the critics have presented them for the last almost half a century. And they are instead, they are better understood as a sort of wake-up calls for more serious work, especially more serious work in the theory of sex. And on one hand, it's also nonsense to reject or to downplay or to avoid the discussion of evolutionary biology in SETI context. But it's also nonsense to claim, as some people, as George Basala claimed, for instance, in that citation I gave at the beginning, that evolutionary biology proves SETI to be misguided and unfounded. So the road is still open, but what we need is really a sort of more theoretical, first of all, more imaginative, more innovative search, and the road for that is open. Thank you for your attention.